My name is Dr. Petra Lietz from the Australian Council for Educational Research, where I'm the editor-in-chief of the journal. Today it's my great pleasure to speak with Dr. Gary Marks. Dr. Marks is Principal Research Fellow at the University of Melbourne and the author of the article entitled Demographic and Socioeconomic Inequalities in Student Achievement Over the School Career, which is to be published in the upcoming November issue of the AJE. Welcome, Gary.
Thank you, Petra.
In your article, you have analyzed longitudinal data of a cohort of students in the state of Victoria in Australia across the years 3, 5, and 7 from 2008 to 2012. Could you please summarize for our audience the main results of that article?
Okay, we're very lucky to get data from the Victorian Department of Education, which was NAPLAN data from 2008 to 2011, and the cohort I concentrated on were kids that were in year 3 in 2008. So we had their NAPLAN results in year 3 in 2008, year 5 in 2010, and year 7 in 2012. Many of the results confirm previous work, which is generally well known. Basically, for example, the gender gap for numeracy favours boys slightly. The gender gap in the domains that are to do with English literacy, reading, writing, spelling and grammar tend to favour girls. Indigenous students perform at a much lower level than non-Indigenous students, about half a standard deviation. Kids from non-English speaking backgrounds tend to do much better than kids, or not much better, but significantly better than kids that are from English speaking backgrounds, especially in spelling for some reason, but also in, I think, writing and grammar. And this difference between non-English speaking background kids and English speaking background kids seems to increase over the school career.
So the non-English speaking background children actually, relative to the English speaking background children, perform better and better, so the sort of the gap increases.
Yes, as they get older, as they move up the grade levels or the year levels in Victorian schools. The relationship between SES and student achievement is fairly well known. It's a moderate relationship. Correlation's about 0.3, explains about 10 to 15% of the variation in student achievement. We got that result. We got slightly stronger effects of SES for numeracy and reading than we did for writing or grammar. Another result that's kind of well known but not often focused on is the strong effects of prior achievement. Prior achievement has a much stronger effect on student achievement than SES or schools. And one of the surprising results is that the effect of prior achievement doesn't change when you look at SES or take into account SES or schools. In other words, the effect of prior achievement on achievement cannot be explained by SES or by school differences or both together.
So really prior achievement, or already the achievement in year 3, is the strongest predictor of differences in year 5, which in turn is the strongest predictor of differences in year 7. Is that the same for numeracy and literacy?
It's true what you say, the year 3 predicts year 5, is the strongest predictor, year 5 predicts year 7. Like I said before, it doesn't seem to make much difference about the school you go to, or SES doesn't make much difference in those relationships.
Just to interrupt there, because you were saying you were analysing data from the government schools.
Yeah, so it's only government school kids. But answer to your question, writing has the kind of weakest link between year 3 and year 5, or year 5 and year 7. Maybe that's to do with the writing test, because it's not as reliable as the other tests. For some reason, spelling seems to have the strongest relationships over time between year 3 and year 5 and year 7, and year 5 and year 7, and the others are in between. The correlations over time are like to approach 0.8 for spelling, about 0.75 for numeracy, 0.7 for reading, and then down to about 0.5 for writing. So they're strong relationships. They're much stronger than the 0.3 correlation between SES and achievement in either domains.
One of your conclusions in the article is that given this very strong effect of prior achievement, policy initiatives aimed at the SES or socioeconomic resources of families or at schools may not be all that effective or as effective as we have hoped? Or what would you say
It's difficult to get into the policy area, I suppose, but most of the policies in education, and for a long time the debate's been about funding of schools, that the idea is that you fund schools that are that serve low SES kids. If you fund those schools more, the argument is that those kids in those schools will do better, and therefore you'll have less inequality and the whole system it will generally lift. But these results really question that. They're saying that SES hasn't got a very strong relationship with achievement, prior achievement's got a much stronger relationship, channeling funds to low SES schools isn't going to change these relationships very much. Maybe what you should do is look at individual students and students that are falling behind. Students have got low achievement in Year 3 and Year 5. Maybe there should be policies to try and lift their performance, right, to make sure that they have reasonable school careers.
And really, because you're saying, or the analysis show that Year 3 is already quite a predictor, so it would really be having to come in prior to Year 3, wouldn't it? So that the difference when the kids get measured at Year 3 wouldn't be as great, and therefore...
Possibly. I mean, it's hard to measure things before kids are about 5 or 6 anyway. And then Year 3, what are they, 8 or 9? I mean, we could be content looking at Year 3 kids and seeing if they're the kids that are doing really badly, see what they can be done for them, like, you know, programs, interventions in their numeracy, interventions in literacy, try and make sure that they improve their lot. And I mean, that's what we should focus on, rather than looking at new funding formulas and arguing about them
for the school level.
Yeah.
So you would be in terms of the analysis, which of course are genuine longitudinal insofar as they follow the same kids over time.
That's right.
So therefore very strong analysis. So therefore you would be saying, you know, let's focus at the individual students who might be already coming in at Year 3 struggling.
Yeah.
Is that sort of, or
yeah,
even trying to get to them beforehand?
I mean, identify them fairly well at Year 3 through NAPLAN. But the other thing you probably should try and focus on is make sure that kids who do well in NAPLAN in Year 3 and Year 5 and Year 7, and if they've got from disadvantaged backgrounds in any way, that they should be allowed to reach their full potential, to use that expression.
Yes.
That you're a smart kid from a rural background or Indigenous background or something like that, low SES, and you're doing well in that plan, you don't want them to fall by the wayside by Year 7 or Year 9 and then not continue the education. Make sure that they don't face insurmountable barriers.
If we come one step back, I think, there's also other analyses that are similar to yours, which show that that the growth, so the change, like the growth rate for example, Indigenous students and non-Indigenous students is similar. They just start at a lower level. Would that be your observation from these analyses?
The change is, all students grow when they go to school, or they all improve in their levels of what they understand, their performance, their achievement, because NAPLAN's very nice in the sense that it's one scale for the whole school career from Year 3 to Year 9. But yes, I mean, the rate of growth between Indigenous kids and non-Indigenous kids is much the same. Mm-hmm. For low SES kids and for SES kids, it's much the same.
Mm-hmm. It's just that they start at different bases and then they grow.
And the other thing that to worry about, I suppose, is that schools too, that there's not much difference in the growth rates between schools.
Okay,
there is some difference between school sector. Now, this paper doesn't talk about school sector because I didn't have the data for it, but I have got some data for there's two sources of data for school sector. There's a Year 9 to Year 12 linkage, and you do find differences between school sectors in terms of growth between Year 9 and Year 12 in student performance. And the other source of looking at school sectors would be the LSAC study, which looks at, has NAPLAN in it as well, but a smaller sample.
Yeah, but staying back with the analysis that you're reporting here, when you say that, okay, socioeconomic status is a weaker or not as strong as a predictor as prior performance, they are separate factors. But is there some argument, and that might be a bit speculation because you can't analyze that prior to year three, but in terms of the context in which the children grow up and that get them to their baseline at year three, isn't it likely that there's something in their socioeconomic, for want of a better word, their context that prepares them better or worse for what they have to do at school?
When I present that finding that prior achievement is the most important predictor of achievement, often the response you get is that it's all about SES still, because SES predicts prior achievement. And I try and emphasise in the paper that when you control for SES, the effect of prior achievement does not go away, it's slightly smaller. So it isn't because SES predicts prior achievement.
They're completely separate.
You'll have some relationship between prior achievement and SES, but not nearly as strong as you would think. It's about cognitive development.
Gary, that was very enlightening. Okay. So thank
thanks
you very
much.
Much.
I enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.